Hi, everybody. My name is Cameron Munter, and I'm the CEO and president of the East-West Institute. I'd like to welcome you to another edition of EWI Podcast, where we seek to explore some of today's pressing global issues with leading thinkers as we track the path of diplomacy in the world today. As always, you're welcome to check out all of our podcast episodes available on our website, on SoundCloud and iTunes, all under the name of East-West Institute. Today, joining me is Ambassador Nicholas Burns. He's currently Goodman Family Professor of the Practice of Diplomacy and of International Relations at Harvard's John F. Kennedy School of Government, and also Director of the Future of Diplomacy Project there. Many of our listeners may remember him as Undersecretary of State for Political Affairs under George W. Bush, where he oversaw the bureaus responsible for U.S. policy in each region of the world at the State Department. Prior to that assignment, Nick was also U.S. Ambassador to NATO and U.S. Ambassador to Greece. Nick, it's a pleasure to have you with us today.
Cameron, thank you very much. Really pleased to be with you, and I have such great respect for you personally and the long association and friendship that you and I have had, but also in your newish role as president and CEO of the East-West Institute. You've got a key job, and I'm happy to be with you today.
Well, Nick, we're glad to be partners with you and with your team. And what we'll be able to do now is talk about the kind of work that we all are working on and have worked on. In this episode, Nick and I will be talking about the current situation at the U.S. State Department under President Donald Trump, how recent changes may impact U.S. foreign policy, especially in regard to Russia, negotiations with North Korea, and also with our European allies. So, Nick, what I'd like to begin is to see if you could give a comment on the change of personnel at the State Department. We have major news recently in U.S. foreign policy. Rex Tillerson is out as Secretary of State. What do you think will be the impact of having Mike Pompeo, assuming that he is confirmed, as the new Secretary of State?
Well, it could well be, Cameron, a major impact. Unfortunately, you know, Rex Tillerson, Secretary of State Tillerson, found himself the first Secretary of State ever fired by Twitter to fire him in that way. He deserved better. He's an honorable person. I thought that, you know, there were two sides of the Rex Tillerson tenure at State. One, I certainly felt as a retired career foreign service officer that Tillerson's management strategy was a failure. He tried to cut the State Department budget by 30%. He laid off some of our most senior and experienced officers. He didn't fill key ambassadorial positions and senior positions back at home base in the State Department. He and President Trump didn't prioritize diplomacy, didn't listen to our senior diplomats. I don't think we've ever seen anything like it, Cameron, in our careers. So I think that's going to be part of his legacy. But on the more positive side, he wanted the United States to stay in the Paris Climate Change Agreement. He wanted the United States to stay in the Iran Nuclear Agreement. He wanted to find his way to talks with the North Koreans, which President Trump has now embraced. He was a voice of conservatism, but of reason and of dialogue with the rest of the world. And with the new Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, very experienced member of Congress, CIA director, I assume he's going to be confirmed by the Senate. And when he is confirmed, I think he may take a much tougher line on Iran. And he may well advise the president to have the U.S. pull out of the Iran nuclear deal, which I think will have very negative consequences for American national interests. And it's unclear if Pompeo will support the kind of exploratory talks with the North Koreans that Tillerson seemed to favor. He might take more of an approach of take it or leave it, denuclearize, or we're going to go back to a war footing. So I think we could be in for a rougher ride, perhaps, in the next couple of years, if that all plays out the way I think it might.
You know, it's interesting when we think about this that Tillerson may have been replaced for many reasons, but one of them might have been to have a new team, to prepare for the North Korea discussions. With 8 out of the 10 posts at the State Department vacant at the top post there,
right.
What do you think, how do you foresee these negotiations taking place? How do you see the preparation for the meeting of President Trump and Kim Jong-un?
Yeah, I published an op-ed in the Financial Times about a week ago, essentially saying it's positive that President Trump's turning towards diplomacy, because the Trump administration had been actively and seriously debating what they called the bloody nose strategy. A unilateral U.S. military strike against North Korea's nuclear facilities designed to knock Kim Jong-un off balance, designed to send them a message that we meant business. And there were a lot of consequences to such a policy that I think could have been could have been potentially catastrophic to the United States. It could have been tens or hundreds of thousands of casualties if we got into a shooting war across the demilitarized zone with a very heavily armed North Korean regime. We don't know if Kim would have used nuclear weapons in return. You couldn't discount that completely. And you don't know if China might have intervened in such a scenario to protect its interests. So I certainly think it's positive, and President Trump's made the right decision to turn towards diplomacy. But Cameron, as you note rightly, the devil's going to be in the details here. At the very least, a senior American diplomat speaking for the president, probably Mike Pompeo, is going to have to go out to talk to the North Koreans in advance to see whether or not they're really serious about denuclearization, negotiating with the United States in a serious and productive way. That's not a given in these talks. You don't want President Trump just to walk into a room with no preparation and meet this 34-year-old, very agile, very crafty Kim Jong-un, President Trump having had no prior experience to do this kind of thing. You need your senior diplomats in place, but we've lost our bench. Joe Yun, Ambassador Joe Yun, our greatest expert in North Korea, retired a couple of weeks ago because nobody was talking to him or listening to him. We do not have an American ambassador in Seoul. We do not have a confirmed American Assistant Secretary of State for East Asia. So the Trump administration does not have these senior diplomats behind them right now in place the way one would normally assume in any other prior foreign policy crisis. And that's going to be a major shortcoming for them.
Well, Nick, you know, one of the things that you and I know from our time in diplomacy is it's not just back and forth across the table, but there's a whole lateral element to things. When you were Under Secretary of Political Affairs, much of what you were doing was coordinating with allies, coordinating with people who aren't so much allies. What do you make of the prospect that not only we'll have a bilateral talk, but what about the role of China? What about the role of Japan and South Korea? What about even Russia? What about the prospect of the six-party talks or any other kind of multilateral way of steering what might happen in North Korea?
Well, that's exactly right. I mean, these aren't going to just be talks between the United States and North Korea. South Korea is our military treaty ally. I would think the South Koreans would be in the room for most of these conversations. We'll have to be closely aligned. President Moon of South Korea comes from the party that has traditionally been very much devoted to conversations and diplomacy with the North. He has a very different view of this, I think, in many ways than President Trump does. So you have to close that circle. Prime Minister Abe of Japan has a lot at stake because North Korea has fired missiles over Japan's territory, Hokkaido, for instance, over the last year. The Chinese are the heavyweight in the region. And one of the reasons why Kim Jong-un may be seeking these talks is because China's been sanctioning North Korea over its unwillingness to talk. And so the Chinese are going to have to be involved in some way, and we're going to need them to exert their leverage at key moments against the North Koreans. And you're never going to keep Putin out of this because, you know, Russia's territory extends all the way to Vladivostok in the Far East, just north of North Korea. And so I don't know if you'll look at a reassembling of the six-party talks of 10 years ago, but you're looking at a multi-party negotiation that is infinitely more complex than a straight one country to another negotiation. It does speak again, Cameron, for the need to have deep State Department involvement of the career officials who know North Korea, who know the language, who know the history. They've got to be part of this to help the Trump administration balance all these competing objectives.
Well, Nick, you know, we're talking about allies. Let me switch to the other part of the world for a little bit. You know, you and I attended the Munich Security Conference in February, which is the traditional meeting of transatlantic security experts, but it's a meeting also dedicated to the tradition of working with allies and working in multilateral fora. Yeah. What would you say was the mood at that event? How did you assess the Munich Security Conference and the state of transatlantic alliance?
I can't remember a time, and I started as an intern with the State Department in 1980. I can't remember a time when a transatlantic relationship has been so weak and strained because President Trump has been, at best, ambivalent about NATO, but he's certainly not leading the NATO alliance like every other American president since Harry Truman. And President Trump has been outright consistently critical of the European Union, the first American president to take that stance again since Harry Truman. I think the Europeans are very worried. I saw it on social media again today that the United States might walk out of the Iran talks, and that's going to be injurious to what the Europeans think is their interest, which is to keep Iran under wraps and to keep it from becoming a nuclear weapons power. The Europeans were, in many ways, the authors of this nuclear deal that go and the negotiations that go all the way back to 2003 between Europe and Iran. So the relationship is very tough right now and strained. And President Trump has been, I think, unwisely embracing a series of authoritarian leaders from the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia to President Duterte of the Philippines. President Trump, I think, very unwisely called President Putin today and congratulated him on his reelection. Well, there was never a doubt about that reelection. In fact, Putin did not run a free and fair election in Russia, and he's just launched a nerve agent attack on Britain. And of course, he launched a major conspiracy against our election. President Trump has been very distant from the most important European leader, Angela Merkel, the Chancellor of Germany, who's come back now for another four-year term. She's been 12 years in power. So the signals that I think you and I heard from the Europeans were, you know, that they feel very distant from Donald Trump. And they disagree with him on many of these important issues that I've mentioned. And they don't feel that he's committed to NATO and the U.S.-European Union relationship the way that every American president has. This is a crisis. I'm very worried about it.
Nick, it's an interesting point that you make, the notion that, for example, should the United States withdraw from this JCPOA, from the nuclear deal with Iran, that what might be aimed as a blow against Iran could inadvertently have great impact and could do great damage to our relationships with such stalwart allies as the Brits, the French, the Germans.
Yeah.
So would you say that it's not just a question of transatlantic allies, it's a question of everyone who has worked with us on the global stage, Iran as well as Europe here?
I think that's right. Since Twitter is in public, I can say this. My friend Michael Schaefer, the former German ambassador to China, and my counterpart a decade ago when we were negotiating sanctions against Iran, he was the political director of the German Foreign Ministry, he tweeted at me this morning saying, please don't leave the United States, in response to something I tweeted, please don't leave this Iran nuclear deal because it's important for Europe and important for European security, and you'll be hurting we Europeans. And I think that's an honest reflection of the anxiety and doubt and all the questions that many Europeans have about the Trump administration and the alliances that we have in the world, NATO in Europe, and our East Asian alliances with Japan, South Korea, Australia, and other countries. These are force multipliers for the United States. They multiply our power. They expand our reach. They're very much in the interest of the U.S. Russia and China have nothing like it. And for the president to come out and attack these alliances and to downgrade them is a fundamental mistake.
Well, Nick, what do you think then might be the result? Is it a positive message that at least the Europeans are going to be working with one another to strengthen their common defense through the new European Defense Fund, et cetera? That is, can there be some good that comes out of this, at least that draws the allies together and maybe makes a new kind of relationship with the United States?
Well, there may be a silver lining. I think President Trump has been right to say that the European allies in NATO and Canada are not spending enough on their own national defense, as they should. We say in NATO that every country should spend a minimum of 2% of gross domestic product on defense. The United States, for instance, spends well over 3.6% of our GDP on defense. Most of the European allies in Canada are at 1%, 1.2%. Canada's below 1%. So the Trump message that Europe needs to spend more is the right message. I think, however, he's overdone it because now he's beginning to say in a lot of his public remarks, and if you don't reach this level, we're going to rethink the alliance. Well, it doesn't make sense to rethink the alliance because the alliance is in the interest, first and foremost, of the United States. It helps us. On 9/11, I was a very new American ambassador to NATO. The allies came to me in the afternoon of September 11th, the Europeans, and said, we want to invoke Article 5 of a NATO treaty. We had never invoked it. That's an attack on one of us. It's an attack on all of us. They said, we want to go to war with you. We want to help defend you against the group that attacked you in New York and in Washington. All of them voted to do so the next day, September 12th, 2001. All of them went into Afghanistan. They're still there. 17 years later, all the allies are still in Afghanistan fighting with us. You can't buy that kind of alliance in the modern world today. We have it. But those countries really help us, and they provide political cover, and they send their troops to fight with us. Why would we want to give that away? I think it's a. I think President Trump is doesn't understand the alliance, doesn't have a history with it, and I think his advisors have not been able to convince him of the major mistake that he's making.
Well, I mean, one way to look at it from Trump's point of view could be that the foreign policy elite, and let's put ourselves in that category, has not adequately explained to the American public what kind of force multiplier NATO is. That is to say, do we have a task ahead of us, those of us who work in foreign policy and are engaged with our allies, to do a better job of explaining to the Americans that the Europeans aren't, as some would say, they're not deadbeats or they're not dead weight, but that they are people who we want to work with rather than something that America is paying for somehow.
Right. And I think that is an obligation that all of us have. All of us who served in Europe and believe in the transatlantic relationship. I wish President Trump would do this because he has the bully pulpit. He's the one in the Oval Office. The rest of us can do this through podcasts like the ones that we're on right now and through press interviews and articles and speaking to Americans around the country. We have to do that. But I think that on balance, the president is pulling us back from a leadership position on immigration and refugees, on trade, certainly on alliances. And he's diminishing in the process, I think, our credibility as a global leader. That's going to hurt us. We cannot dig a moat around America and pull up the drawbridges and think we're going to succeed, not when every six American jobs depends on exports and depends on businesses that need to succeed internationally as well as in American businesses as well as at home. We need to be out there in the world, and we have a lot of friends in the world if we would just work with them and listen to them.
Well, I mean, there's a lot of people out there, and we will be seeing how the relationships build. One of the countries we do have to engage with, even though it's very difficult these days, is Russia. Now, how long is it that President Putin has been in power? Nearly 20 years now.
Nearly 20 years.
How do you see the relationship with post-election Russia?
Oh, I think the relationship with Moscow right now, between Moscow and Washington, is as bad as it's ever been since the fall of communism and the fall of the Soviet Union. Certainly much worse than it was under the President and General Secretary Gorbachev in the late Soviet period. There is no trust between Moscow and Washington. We are competing with each other in most parts of the world. The Russians have a zero-sum mentality about us. Anytime the United States succeeds, Putin thinks it's bad for Russia, and the reverse is true. When Russia's going well, it'll hurt the United States. I think we have to defend against Russia in several important respects, contain Russian power in Eastern Europe, because, of course, they invaded Georgia in 2008. They invaded Ukraine in 2014. They still have troops in the Donbass region of eastern Ukraine. They've annexed Crimea. No European leader had done that since Hitler and Mussolini 75, 80 years ago, annexed someone else's territory. The Russians have been trying to destabilize our NATO allies, Estonia and Latvia and Lithuania, the Baltic countries. So what President Obama and now President Trump have done, and I agree with this part of President Trump's policy, we're building up the strength of the American military in Europe, not to fight Russia, but to contain Russian power, to be strong enough to do that. That's a positive move. And I think we'll be in this mode probably until the Putin generation passes from power sometime in the next 10 to 15 years. I can't see us, we cannot agree to Russian attempts to destabilize Europe because Europe's too important to us.
If I could break in on that, you talk about, 10 to 15 years. That's disheartening in the sense that it means that you're implying that things are going to remain frozen, that there's not a lot that can be done in the next decade.
I'm assuming Putin's 65 years old. He's in looks to be in good physical shape. He's energetic. He may, like Xi Jinping, become president for life. The Russian Constitution actually does not allow him to run for another six-year term beyond 2024. So he's just begun yesterday, his first day of a six-year term. But knowing Putin and knowing the autocratic system that he runs, he could certainly change the Russian Constitution and become a leader for life. His generation was formed during the Soviet Union. He's an ex-KGB officer. I think he feels entirely competitive with the United States. I don't see him changing his views. So I do think we'll be in a mode of trying to limit Russian power and contain the worst aspects of Russian power in Europe for the next 10 to 15 years, we're going to have to keep the lines open and talk to him, because we'll need his help from time to time on counterterrorism. We'll need his help in Afghanistan. He'll be an actor, as we've discussed, on North Korea. So I certainly would not advocate shutting down relations with him. You should talk to your enemies and adversaries, but we got to have our eyes open. He's not our friend. And I think President Trump has made a fundamental mistake in being so soft, I would say weak, with Putin. And Trump has positioned himself as some kind of supplicant to Putin. I don't think Putin respects that. He respects strong people who hold to their positions. He respects people like Angela Merkel. I don't think he's going to respect the weakness of President Trump. President Trump, of course, has never criticized Putin, despite all the outrages that Putin has committed against the United States since Trump took office. And President Trump had been resistant for 8 months to implement the sanctions that Congress voted in response to Putin's conspiracy to undermine our election. So I think Moscow is looking at Trump as a paper tiger, someone they could push around, and that's not a good place for the U.S. to be.
You mentioned that, you know, in certain ways we could look to the Russians, you know, that there may be areas like counterterrorism, there may be areas like the conflicts in Afghanistan and Syria where, who knows, we may be able to make common cause. How do you see that as possible if, in fact, things are as harsh or as cold as many think, and as I think you've implied? How do we work with them at the same time that we are clear-eyed about the relationship?
Well, you know, I think that we are accustomed to this kind of relationship. Throughout the long decades of the Cold War, we always had an embassy in Moscow. They had an embassy in Washington. We talked every day during the 4.5 decades of the Cold War, and we learned to balance those issues where we had to oppose the Soviets, in this case the Russians, and those issues where we might be able to work together. We wanted our diplomats to be talking to them so that we'd have a good sense of what was on their mind and how we had to defend against them. And I think that's how we should approach the period ahead. If we can actually cooperate with Russia on some issues, we should do that. But we're going to have to be tough-minded in defending our position in Europe, because NATO depends on it and American national security depends on it.
So, Nick, you've outlined some very tough situations here, I think very honestly and openly, and been very critical of some of the policies that are out there. Let's turn this on its head a little bit. Do you see parts of the world that you are more optimistic about, or do you see trends or broad trends, transnational trends, that you would say work in the favor not only of America, but in terms of the values that we hold and for our allies as well? Is there something you're optimistic about?
Yes, and thank you for asking that question, because we don't want to depress everybody on this podcast. You know, I think if you look at the United States itself and look at our power position in the world, we should be confident about our place in the world. We have the strongest economy, the largest economy, the most innovative economy. And if you look at the 21st century future of the global economy in nanotechnology and in biotechnology and artificial intelligence and the emerging digital economy, we are the global leader. So our economy, our young people are prepared. I think they're well positioned to succeed in the world. We've got the strongest and largest and most proficient military in the world. We had a first-rate diplomatic corps until the Trump administration began to weaken it. Our society, our commitment to democracy, human rights, to education is admired throughout the world. I teach now at Harvard, and a lot of our universities, our university system is the best in the world. And we have students coming here from all over the world, to the University of Texas and to Caltech and to Michigan State and the University of North Carolina and to Harvard and Boston College, in order to get what we have, which is this great university system, this commitment to higher education. So we should feel good about our position in the world. I do think we need self-confidence. I interviewed our mutual friend, former Secretary of State Condoleezza Rice, in a public forum last year in 2017, and I asked her about challenges to America, and she, you know, without hesitating, she shot back. She said, "We've lost our self-confidence. We've lost our sense of that we can be a great positive force in the world." And I think Condi Rice is right about that. I don't think President Trump, frankly, has given us that self-confidence. He's been more of a divider. He's been talking down America's role in the world, traditional role, and I think that's a mistake. So as an American, I think we're going to succeed in the 21st century, and we just need leaders who would help us succeed and help us remain engaged in the world and involved in the world as a global leader. So much depends on us. We both know that from our career.
Well, you know, Nick, I want to close up with a little bit of a discussion about some of the work that we do in common, that which comes under the rubric that I call the new diplomacy, which fits very closely with what you've just said about America and its strengths, that yes, there is the American government and the way the American government expresses itself, but there's also American society. There are, let's put it this way, as we've always said in the past, if war is too important for the generals, well, you and I know that diplomacy may be too important to be left to the diplomats, that people like university professors, people like businessmen, people like civic leaders are the representatives in a 21st century diplomacy. And you and I have worked at the Future of Diplomacy Project at Harvard to try to explore that idea. What is diplomacy? How is it going to be different? And I would argue to you that diplomacy is, in a sense, becoming a broader practice, a practice of people who are citizens who are addressing healthcare overseas or addressing transnational issues like climate change, if in certain senses, the governments aren't in a position to do so. Is this part of what you're doing as a professor of practice at Harvard, up at the Belfer Center, Future of Diplomacy Project? How do you feel this new diplomacy might play out in the century to come?
Well, I think you're absolutely right to point to the fact that diplomacy, America's relations with the rest of the world, are not just the preserve of our government, Washington, that all of us as citizens can and should play a role in this. Our businesses can, our NGOs can, our mayors and governors can. You know, since President Trump, I think very unwisely, took the United States out of the Paris Global Climate Change Agreement, we're the only country in the world, not part of it, the only country in the world. You've seen real leadership from Governor Jerry Brown of California, Governor Charlie Baker here in Massachusetts, a Republican, from former New York Mayor Mike Bloomberg, and you see them stepping up, the states, mayors, you see NGOs stepping up. On human rights, we have Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, are two organizations that have a big footprint in the United States that are international, but there are a lot of Americans work for them, and they are leaders around the world. One of the areas that's most hopeful is the huge progress being made on public health globally. And think of the role that the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, the Michael Bloomberg Foundation have played in the fight against polio. We're just about, the human race, to eradicate polio. We haven't eradicated a global disease since smallpox. Bill Gates thinks that malaria can be eradicated in his lifetime. These are major human achievements. And they're being produced not just by governments. The U.S. government's been fundamentally involved, playing a very positive role under George W. Bush and Barack Obama. But our NGOs are stepping up. And the Gates Foundation, wealthiest foundation in the world, is putting its money to great use and making a big impact. So I think you're right to stress, and this is a big role for the East-West Institute, that we citizens can help to create a better world, a safer world, a more just and peaceful world, if we direct our attentions to some of these great institutions like yours, help them succeed, and help them play the role they have to play in the world.
Well, Nick, we see you and your colleagues at Harvard and at other institutions around the world as our partners, people who are having the thought leadership to create the ideas that will address these problems in a way that I wouldn't say replace traditional diplomacy, but enhance and support traditional diplomacy, so that we like to think, I would say here at East West, and I think you believe up at Harvard as well, that what we're doing is not somehow challenging traditional diplomatic norms, but making them richer, making them fuller, and trying to figure out ways to solve problems in creative ways that, you know, maybe traditional diplomacy, especially in the context and the difficult context that you've so clearly explained today, that in this new context, other people can play a role. We're very pleased to partner with you and delighted to have you with us. I don't know if there's anything about that or any other topic you want to finish up with.
Well, we're pleased, Cameron, that you're a fellow in our Future Diplomacy Project up here at Harvard. Our diplomacy project tries to bring global leaders to Harvard to work with our students to make them better informed about the world, but also to give them the courage and confidence that they can go out and make a difference themselves. And so I think we've arrived at a time in the second decade of the 21st century where, because of social media, because of jet travel, we can all make a difference in the world. And we have such a stake, we Americans, in the rest of the world. We're the global leader If our government's not going to lead, if our president is stepping away from global leadership, well, the American citizenry doesn't have to do that. And certainly your organization, and I hope our organization here at Harvard, are examples of that.
Well, that's a great partnership that we hope we can enhance the government's ability to do things in whichever way we can. So before we close the show, I'd like to really thank Ambassador Nick Burns for his time and sharing his insights on the EWI podcast. Look for us on our website, SoundCloud and iTunes, under the name of East-West Institute, where you can listen, follow, and subscribe so you won't miss our conversations. Thank you all for listening. Thank you for your time, Nick.
Thanks, Cameron.
Thank you.